Hey everybody, coming up on Sports Central, we have a very special treat for you. A half a year in review with some of the best athletes in the world, some of the best events. It's coming up next on Sports Central. Stick around, everybody. Hey everybody, and welcome to Sports Central. I'm Mark Jackson. To my right, Mr. Neal Duncan, our co-host. And Neal, this is a very special time of the year, not because we're about 6 weeks away from the NFL's preseason games kicking off, but you take a look back to January 1st, and it has been a whirlwind of events, special athletes, so many memories over the last few months. And, you know, we have a show that's designed to bring out some of the best of our amateur and pro athletes here from Polk County, some of the best events in the world here in Polk County. And we're going to talk about, you know, how that's impacted actually the whole region and the state of Florida. But we've traditionally focused, and so many people focus in on the stick and ball sports, basketball, baseball, softball, soccer, and some of the better known sports. But we've had some real unique events here in Polk County that are just pumping thousands and thousands of people into the community, spending the night eating in restaurants, and literally hundreds of millions of dollars throughout the years for Polk County because of sports and special events.
Absolutely. You talk about over 220 events, like 226, something like that. The number always changes.
Yeah, well, but it keeps going up.
It does. It
never goes down.
But you talk about unique events such as sitting volleyball and, of course, taekwondo, and table tennis has been a growing sport, and we've had a lot of those over the years in Polk County. But Quidditch. I said Quidditch, and if you didn't see those shows that we highlighted, that, of course, this first segment brought to us by Hollywood Signs, want to mention them first, but Quidditch, Harry Potter, the movies, it's a growing sport, so it's just an example of, if it's a good event, morally sound, all those things, is going to generate overnight stays and economic impact for Polk County. We're going to go after it in diversifying that portfolio. I know Mark Jackson has talked about this many times in staff meetings, but you have to be diversified, and we absolutely are in our events, and we got some great footage.
Oh, we got some unbelievable footage, and in some really unique sports. I think you're going to enjoy this, everybody. Stick around. Mark and Neal will be back after this special segment on PGTV's Sports Central.
What's the date? Where's it at? Where's it?
Yeah.
Give us all the components.
Exactly. So it'll be January 22nd. So it's coming up in just a couple weeks. Mm-hmm. It begins at 7 p.m. in downtown Winter Haven. We're starting out right by the library, our typical route. And we head north and go around Lake Silver and carry up on Martin Luther King Drive and come back, finish around Lake Silver, come around Central Park, and then finish right there at the library again. So it's a great run, 5K, you know, so you're going 3.1 miles. We have, you know, runners that actually my younger brother last year was our bicyclist to lead the pack. And we had a runner who was so talented that he outrun my little brother on the bike. He was like, yeah, something's wrong with that man. You know, but can we have every level.
It's obviously a night run, 7 o'clock in 2 weeks. It's going to be dark as, you know, pitch. But the fact of the matter is, are you providing glow sticks, or do you recommend people bring them?
We
because
definitely
a lot of runners like that. Some of them don't, but
now it's optional. We will have some of accessories, bracelets, necklaces for sale there. But we encourage everybody to do glow sticks, necklaces. There's glow in the dark hairspray, costumes, just glow. The glowier, the merrier. It's exciting.
Exactly.
We love it.
Exactly.
What's all this stuff, you know, and my wife runs all over the country in these things and all this type of stuff, and I don't ever ask her, but you know, all these girls, they get dressed up, and they're not guys too, I guess. Well, I know.
Oh yeah.
You know, in different. I mean, is you so in other words, you're encouraging.
Absolutely.
And this is a festival.
To match the theme.
Absolutely.
Just
exactly. You get little kids, mothers pushing strollers, runners, I mean, men, women, you've got the whole family.
And they're all dressed up.
It's so adorable.
All about fun.
Exactly. All about fun. Exactly. All about fun and giving back to the community.
And coaching boys is different than coaching girls. And tell us a little bit about how you've made that transition, because obviously your record, you know, has been phenomenal here.
Well, I think the biggest difference is the girls' game is played below the rim. The boys' game is played above the rim. Thus, everyone, the excitement for the boys' game, you know, there's dunks and there's everything. But then there's the personal side. On the women's side, a little bit of admiration has to go on there of you as a coach and a fatherly figure. Mm-hmm. On the boys' side, you know, their whole thing is everybody wants to be in the NBA.
Yeah.
You know, the girls know that the WNBA is the dream. Boys all think it's a reality until everything hits. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, you know, and in the women's game, I try to be a lot more technically sound mm-hmm. on what we do, you know, so that's the biggest difference, I think.
Okay. Yeah, that's, you know, and different coaches have analyzed that differently. You know, guys that have coached both boys and male and female teams, and that's an interesting perspective, but particularly the boys are playing above the rim, the girls are playing below the rim. Technically a little more sound.
It is, because they have to work harder mm-hmm. on being able to handle the ball. You see it, the boys will jump from, you know, try to jump from the foul line. Girls, we don't do that. We throw floaters, we use the backboard, we do the basics, you know. And some of the good women's teams, if you watch them, that's where they're the best at, is around the rim. Because in women's basketball, a lot of layups are missed. So that's one of the things that we concentrate heavily on.
Coach McGriff, I know you guys have had a very spirited schedule so far this season, to put it lightly, playing some of the best competition, not only in the state of Florida, but around the country. And I know you've said in the past it doesn't hurt to have a Division I signee like Tony Bradley, who's going to North Carolina. Right. That helps you get into some of those marquee events. Talk to us about what the team's been up to.
I'm not sure I'd want to do it again. I think it's hard on me. The kids, you know how kids are today. It's 30 seconds and then they forget about it. And we lost, we were 5-0, and we lost 7 out of 8 games. We go down and play Miami, New Orleans. They're the best team in 6A. They won 4 state titles in the last 4 years, 6 of the last 10 years. We go on to Wellington, they lost the 8A. So we have 8 classes in Florida now. They were the 8A state champs last year. We were up by 20 and blew a lead against them. So we're 5-2 going into Christmas. We had already beat Sagemont, which is the number one team in 3A. All right, we go to the City of Palms Classic, which is the best tournament in the country. There's about 6 USA Today top 25 teams in that tournament. It's down in Fort Myers. And we just get hammered. We play the number 2 ranked kid in the country, Jason Tatum.
Going to Duke, right?
He's going to Duke. He puts 30 on us. The next day, we play a team from called Wesleyan Christian from North Carolina. They've got 2 kids going to Tennessee, 1 going to Texas, 1 going to Iowa, something like that. They beat us by about 15. And then we play the number 2 junior in the country, who Duke, Kentucky, North Carolina after, Michael Porter, and he puts 37 on us. And so it's like, ouch and yikes.
Tell us about the event, and then secondly, what does it mean to Stream Song to have this event? This is really huge.
It is. It's our first national championship at Stream Song, and the USGA, the United States Golf Association, hosts 13 national championships per year. And 10 of them are amateur events. Mm-hmm. So it's really nice to be able to say this is the first in the Tampa Bay area of a national championship from the USGA. And there's been 21 in Florida. This is the 21st.
Wow.
So
wow.
We're excited, and it means a ton to the resort. We want to promote amateur golf. Mm-hmm. We want to promote not the smaller tournaments, but national events, national championships are important. But it's not necessarily like most people follow the PGA Tour and the huge events that they have every week. Mm-hmm. And this is an event that is very a homey feeling, because you'll have probably 100 people watching every day, mm-hmm. and they can walk pretty much with the players the whole way around, as long as they're standing back just a little bit so they can hit their shots.
Wow.
You know, now, as you watch this and these players golfing, and you have the folks following them, I would think for the golfer, because I have this problem as soon as somebody starts watching and other people pull up, you know, sometimes I get a good shot, other times I don't. You really have to be able to zone out everything around you with all these people standing around for these girls when they're getting ready to hit the ball and, you know, everybody's standing there watching you.
Well, I think, first of all, the age groups, it's from 11 to 70. Is the age groups that have qualified through the 28 sites throughout the U.S. Mm-hmm. And I think most of them are pretty talented and used to that pressure because this is what they do.
This is what they
and
do every day.
They're some great athletes out there. I know that we have 17 from Florida that are going to be participating that have qualified.
We're working on our 30th year this coming next year. And the MS Society has a chapter in Orlando and has a chapter in Tampa as well. Mm-hmm. And together they have anywhere from 1,000 to 1,500 riders each year. Anywhere from April to May is when the event is. This year the event is the 21st and 22nd of May. And it is from Fantasy of Flights, mm-hmm. which is off I-4, and it goes to the Omni Champions Gate. That's the first time that they've had it there. In the past year, they've had it at Bach Tower, mm-hmm. right around the corner here, to Orlando and back. So the ride consists of 2 days. It's 50 miles, 75 miles, or 100 miles the first day, and then the second day is 50 miles. So I've elected to do the 100-mile century ride mm-hmm. each year, and this will be my 8th year that I've ridden the 100-mile ride. And in Team Rockwell, we're made up of a bunch of people in the Tampa Bay area, and we've raised close to $65,000-$70,000, our own team itself,
wow.
with about 65 riders. And on our team, we have, I think, two people that we have MS that ride in the ride itself.
And actually ride,
yeah. I'm one of them, and it's a great group of people. Not just Team Rockwell, but the whole chapter itself and all those teams that form for this, you know, event each year.
Everybody, welcome back to Sports Central, and Mark Jackson along with Neal Duncan. I mean, that was some great stuff.
Absolutely.
You know, I mean, and you just can't say enough about the quality of broadcasting, production, the direction here at PGTV. I mean, you've got some world-class people that are just doing an unbelievable job, and I think that last segment is a testament to the talent that
yeah.
we have here. And it's just, it's really some good stuff.
Well, they do a great job in helping us to promote, and part of the reason for Sports Central to even exist is to help the citizens of Polk County know about the events and know that they can go to these events. And another partner that helps us is the segment sponsor, which is the Ledger Media Group. They do a great job of making sure that our local citizens know about these great events coming in.
Well, you know, and you got to take your hats off to the Ledger Media Group as well, because, you know, we just celebrated our, I believe it was 16th All Sports Awards and
yeah.
Hall of Fame.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, what a tribute to all the professional and amateur athletes that have come through
yep.
Polk County and, you know, day in and day out, and all the champions that come out of this county. I mean, it's just not normal.
Yeah. And, this segment sponsor for this, I don't think I finished my thought, but they are the segment sponsor of this second segment.
Absolutely. You're suffering from a little dementia
sometimes
there,
just,
Mr.
Sometimes
Duncan?
There's a thought and it just goes away.
I get
squirreled, but
that's okay. Some
them.
People need, you know, a little help.
You're my rock,
that.
Mark.
Yeah, I understand that. It's funny, though, you know, sports, arts, and culture. Of course, the Olympics have
yeah.
the cultural side of the Olympics
mm-hmm.
and special events. And it just doesn't always have to be about sports or a portion of its sports, but we are so blessed here to have events that are sports. There's some arts and culture involved in some of them. There's
nice blend.
Entertainment involved
mm-hmm.
in a lot of them. And the state's largest convention is in Polk County. No, it's not in Orlando or Miami, Jacksonville, Tampa. It's right here in Polk County,
yeah.
Sun and Fun.
Right.
You know, there's a lot of them. The Detroit Tigers, you know, yes, sporting event, but
the longest relationship in Major League Baseball history, just signing another 20-year agreement. By the end of that one, 100 years.
Yeah, they last season, 80th season of spring training. This coming season will be 81st. But it's not just about the 50 or so days that the big league team is here. That Tigers' economic impact is year-round, but we certainly do appreciate them.
Flying Tigers and all the medical rehab, the training and so on. I mean, it's an economic engine. Continues to pump money into Polk County, like we always talk about. Sports and tourism is about pumping money into the Polk County economy, which makes us all better off and creates thousands and thousands of jobs.
Well, and going after new events, such as the Miss Florida pageant, you know, the big announcement we had in the first half of this year, bringing this event to the Lakeland Center, to Yuki Theater. So it's exciting times.
It's not in Miami. It's not in Orlando. It's not in Tampa. Not in St. Pete. Not in Jacksonville. It's in Polk County.
Yeah.
And what does that say about, you know, the quality of life here, the people that are here, and the assets that we have in terms of our venues and infrastructure?
Well, you know, some great packages, some great interviews. This is exciting. And we're only halfway through the year, so just a great job this year in Polk County.
Here we go, everybody. We've got some very special events, some very special segments. Check this out. Mark and Neal, we'll be back. Stick around.
Talk to us a little bit about the grand, I want to make sure I have this right, the Grand Slam Adoption Event. What is that? Where's it at? Who's going to be there?
Well, it's a new event for us here in Polk County. It's the 2016 Grand Slam Adoption Event, hosted by Kate Upton and Justin Verlander. So,
wow.
Yeah, getting better than that.
It was really, really cool.
Well, I don't really care that much about Justin, but it was like,
come on now. You know. You're sports guys.
It took him like 5 seconds to go there.
Yeah.
But we were talking about earlier the Tigers and what they do. And of course, Justin has led that or been a part of that over his years. You know, he started with the Flying Tigers, and now he's Mr. Everything, Cy Young Award winner. To lend that kind of credibility and that name recognition, in addition to, you know, an actress like Kate, that's huge for Lakeland, right?
Oh yeah, dynamic duo. You know, the event is awesome in concept. This will be the second year they did it. First year here. Last year they did it down in Brevard County, and they did a wonderful, it was a wonderful event, supported the Sheriff's Department down there as well as the local animal services. But the connection with Justin and Kate being here locally, Ron Myers over at the Director of Operations, the Florida Operations for the Tigers, said, we need this here. So somehow or another, they were able to finagle it that they're bringing the event here, and by chance, we actually got involved through one of our board members. When the opportunity came up, they said, hey, Kate's coming, do you want to do an event? And we're like, heck yeah.
Sure.
So yeah, and it's just kind of exploded from that. And Connie's here because she's our safety net manager, of course, but she's very active in animal rescues and knows about the Wins for the Warriors and the Canines for Warriors and the relational aspect of what the therapeutic value of the animals is for the veterans coming back. So
these events don't just show up.
No, they don't.
In Polk County, and you know, you've got a little taste for what it's like to get out there and do some recruiting and so on. It took a lot of effort and a lot of people to help you pull this whole thing off.
It has taken a lot of people. I have to say, this event would not be possible without our great partners. When we decided that we would be bringing CityWorks to Florida, one of the first things I did was make a few phone calls. I partnered immediately with the City of Winter Haven, of course, the Winter Haven Chamber of Commerce, the Winter Haven EDC, and the wonderful people at Visit Central Florida.
Well, there you go.
Well, we're talking about CityWorks. What is it?
Well, CityWorks is, I like to kind of call it the unconference a little bit. Usually, in my position, I attend a lot of conferences, and they're all wonderful and filled with great information. The difference between this one is the format, I have to say. It runs from about 8:30 in the morning to about 8:30 at night. So the day spans through burst talks similar to TED Talks, if you're familiar. So little talks that are about anywhere from 10 to 40 minutes. The topics will range all over the board, from music to planning to streets and how they should be laid out to social justice projects. It's everything and anything that creates a better city and a better place. Throughout
the day, people who attend this conference will hear these great innovative speakers, and then it continues over into a nighttime event, which is structured specifically for connectivity. Our hope with this conference is that people will come away with some relationships with other people who are doing great things within their community throughout the state of Florida. And so hopefully, year after year as we grow this, people who attend will be able to have contacts and build relationships with other people within the state. And so when there's an issue or a project, you know, you can call up somebody in Tallahassee or maybe call up somebody over in Fort Meade and say, hey, we're doing this. What do you think? Do you have any experience with a project similar to this? And really start preparing the state of Florida for the growth that is about to have. You know, all of the numbers, Mark, as you were saying, are looking incredible for people coming into the Florida, and our projected growth is really remarkable. That growth is exciting, and we are welcoming that, but at the same time, I think there are so many beautiful cities like Winter Haven and Lake Wales and Bartow and Haines City and Mulberry and Fort Meade. All of these towns need to be and are very aware of preserving their authenticity while they grow. Mm-hmm. And an event like this that helps us all connect and share information, mm-hmm. I think is a wonderful platform for that.
It is a foodie extravaganza that we're gonna have at the Lakeland Center June 11th and 12th, times Saturday between 10 and 6 and Sunday from 11 to 5. And it's all about adding flavor to your food. That's what we wanna show the Polk County and the general area. We want to give them hits and suggestions and recommendations on how to add that flavor by providing them access to both taste and buy different hot sauces, salsas. We got cheesecake, we have avocado things, we have a salsa that's made with zucchini. There are all kinds of different and unique products that are going to be at this store. Over 50 vendors and over 70 booths at the Lakeland Center, like I said, June 11th and 12th.
Dana, I imagine for the people that haven't been to an event like this, they're gonna really be awakened to all the different types of sauces that there are. And I mean the varieties that are out there, that if you're not a hot sauce, you know, fan and use hot sauce a lot, you're really gonna have a neat experience learning all the different varieties that are out there.
And we have so many different varieties. We have things from a company called Riva Foods, where they add the sauce to a brownie mix. Gives it a whole new flavor profile. They'll have the brownies there for you to try and then the sauce to buy. They'll have the recipe there as well, so that you could then go home and produce the product. It's amazing things. Like I said, the zucchini. We have Parajani's, who makes a guava barbecue sauce. Again, adding flavor to just regular everyday barbecue, just taking it up to a different level with the different flavor profiles. And it's not a, you know, it's not a hot sauce show. It's a flavor show. So we have From the Mound. Now, do we and are we gonna do things that will burn your face off? Yes.
Hello,
we sure will.
Burn your face off.
But hence the trophy that we have in front of us. One of the activities on Saturday, around 1-2-ish time period, we're going to have the Lolly Lickathon sponsored by Intensity Academy, where the goal is that you dissolve the world's hottest lollipop.
Now, what is this again? The Lolly
Lickathon? It's called the Lolly Lickathon.
The Lolly Lickathon.
The lollipop is 1.5 million Scoville units. Now, to put that in perspective, a jalapeno, 3,000 to 5,000 Scoville units. The sucker is 1.5 million. It has the current Guinness World Record holder, the Smokin' Ed's Carolina Reaper in the lollipop. So you get, you start off with that sweet lollipop taste, and then it goes all downhill from there.
We our mission statement's about not only raising money for charity, but developing the concept of barbecue, and we want to really get one of our premier and legacy sponsors of our event, Public Supermarkets, has just been incredible, along with a lot of their vendors, to help this event grow, to develop the concept of the good backyard cook.
Well, you know, Polk County arguably is the barbecue capital of Florida.
A whole month is going to be gobbled up with great
almost 6
barbecue.
Weeks of barbecue, you know, and we've got some great guests coming up, talk a little bit about Smoke on the Water, which is another superb. But Pig Fest, I mean, I love going there because, one, you can park. Number two, you can get in, you know, without any problems. The food is outstanding. The music is outstanding. But you've had some challenges along the way this year that you've never, ever had before. What's happening
in
Tiger
Town?
That's
true. We're lucky that with our contract that extends the Tigers in Lakeland and the major construction project, almost $40 million construction project that's going on there over this two-year period, the runway, the northern run portion of the runway between the stadium and the practice field will no longer be available as part of the venue of our event. So we've had to restructure the event, reorganize parking and so forth, put in all the infrastructure necessary to accommodate over 120 teams this year.
Wow. 120 teams?
120 teams.
That's unbelievable. And we'll
have the leading teams in the country in Kansas City Barbecue Society at this event. Many of those teams competing for points for Team of the Year, for the $20,000 worth of prize money we give away is important, but it's probably no more important than having the certifications and the opportunity to quote.
You know, what's amazing is the it's amazing where people actually will come from for these events. I mean, they're just not your local barbecuers. They come from outside the state and actually some of them from very far away.
Yeah, I mean, we're at Henley Field this season. Obviously, with the renovations going on at Joker Marchant Stadium,
which we can't talk about. Right. It's a big secret.
That's not a secret. I just, you know, things always change sometimes. So I just want to be on point. But no, we're at Henley Field this year, and it's actually been really good. You know, I think there was some, you know, question marks going in over there because of the age of the stadium and the capacity, you know, limitations being only 1,000 capacity. So, but we've made it work. It's been fun. I was telling Neil earlier that it's just, you know, everybody's right on top of the game, you know, with the way the seating is, you know, Florida Southern plays there. So obviously it's always in use, but it's been fun. And, you know, we're still doing things. We still do our Dollar Mondays and all of our same normal promotions. So it's been good.
Well, Paul's still out there.
Yeah.
Is he?
Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah, I mean, you talk about, it's funny how things come full circle because the Tigers used to spring train at Henley Field, yep. And now the Flying Tigers are playing there because of the renovations. And it's neat the relationship between the city and, of course, Florida Southern College and the Tigers. And it's kind of neat to go out there and see the Flying Tigers playing there because of all the history, you know, the Al Kalines of the world, yep. that used to do spring training there. Talk about that aspect of it.
It is, and actually it's funny that you mentioned Al. Because actually one of our first couple of games there at Henley, we had to put the tarp on the field. And then we were waiting and, you know, it was raining, so we were kind of in a delay. And I come off the field from pulling the tarp and I see Al Kaline standing there. And I was like, I thought he was up in Detroit or something. Here he is, he's standing there. And he was asking how everything was going. I was like, oh, good. And I was like, have you seen underneath the stadium? Because that was where the old clubhouse and the, you know, used to be underneath the stadium. So it was kind of a surreal moment for me thinking about the history of that place with, you know, Babe Ruth and all those guys playing there. And sure enough, I'm walking underneath there with Al Kaline, a Hall of Famer from the Tigers. And we're underneath there and we go in and we look at the old locker room that's like under there. It's not used for anything. You know, it's old school. It looks like it could be in a museum, but it was so cool to think about being in there with that guy.
Right.
You know, it was pretty cool. But there's a lot of history there and it's been really well maintained. And Florida Southern has been great letting us use there and working with us on everything. Mm-hmm. So I think fans have understood that and realized the significance of that ballpark. So it's been cool.
Everybody, and welcome Sports Central once again. Segment number 3 coming up, Mr. Duncan.
Cleveland Heights Golf Course, a great partner. Of course, they're in the city of Lakeland. They do a great job. And again, we talked about sports, we talked about tourism. They're on both sides of it because they host great special events there, and they also host a number of visitors that come into the Polk County area. So,
well, Cleveland Heights. Yeah, well, not too long ago, did a a sports show, and I can't remember if it was Sunshine Network or Fox Sports or whatever that we it did in conjunction with them on the Symetra Golf Tour that we held there, and that was a fun show to do. And we were talking a little bit offset, and you know, I asked the question, well, what's the toughest sport that you've ever had to broadcast and announce? And you know, I've had some weird ones. I had trampoline and tumbling, sports acrobatics, of course, a lot of tons of water skiing and wakeboarding, but golf was my toughest. That was the toughest sport to be the anchor for.
You know, it's, you have to talk like this.
Well, that's hard, but you've got to slow everything down.
Okay.
You know, and it's not like
it's not you're, the fast action.
Yeah, you're not building energy. You're not pointing things out that the viewers can't see and all this type of stuff. It's more about the personalities there, right, how they're playing that day, how they're playing in the season. You know, there's a lot more data that goes into producing a good show for that.
Right.
But anyway, a little insight into my strange life, career, whatever. But it's
well, that's good stuff. And I mean, it is tough. And going from one sport to the other, and of course, with what we do on a daily basis, 226 events, we've got great events, but we've also got great teams, and we certainly have tremendous athletes. And one of the offerings of this show is to highlight some of those athletes. And this is one of our favorite segments that we do on the show.
Oh, there's no question about it. And when you take a look at what comes out of Polk County, the role models that that we have here, you know, Rowdy Gaines, Tracy McGrady, you know, have always kept a high profile, kept their integrity about them. Chris Sale, you know, some of the more recent ones, Wade Davis, and then you think about all the professional water skiers, Zane Schwenk, and all of these guys, the Bonifay kids, and the professional pro athletes,
right,
is just phenomenal. Golfers, I mean,
yeah,
holy
just to
smokes.
Name a few, you look at Andrew McCutcheon and the Pounceys, and you look at all these individuals that are in.
Ray Lewis was another one.
Yeah,
just honored him last week.
Yeah, into the Polk County Sports Hall of Fame. Yep. So, but they all started. They all had
right
their
here
roots as amateur athletes in Polk County, and that's what this segment is where we spotlight some of those athletes.
Absolutely.
Up-and-comers.
Well, some people said, well, is it in the water? No, not really. But I really think it has more to do with the quality of the coaching.
Mm-hmm.
I think the mindset, you know, there's a culture of athleticism in Polk County, mm-hmm, wanting to be the best.
Right.
I think it has more to do with that. And it also says a lot about the parents and the support they provide these kids as they're growing up. So it's all great stuff. And I think you're going to enjoy this next segment. It's really my personal favorite in terms of all the segments because it focuses on the thing that matters most, and that's the people of Polk County. Check this out, everybody. We'll be back right after this.
Well, I started cycling as a recreational. I did a couple of times first, and then I started getting into it. I meet a lot of people who's really competitive, and they push me around, so I see that it's another way to represent the, I would like to make the national team, so that's another way to represent the U.S. and just only change the uniform from camouflage to a national uniform, so it's a good way to keep competing. The hand cycle have given me so much back because I cannot do much because my injuries, my lower extremity injuries, my foot and my back. So with the hand cycle, I can do so much now. I can be able to compete, to be in competitive level compared to other different sports. When I was injured, I was my physical abilities and sports that was really limited until I was introduced to biking. Biking have given me so much. It's big chance for everybody. It's, I used to be at the house like in pain, chronic pain, taking pills. It helped me so much of physical and mentally and being able to be open up, trying to be open with more people, be around people with the same disability. So It's big goal for me. I enjoy biking because I do ride a lot with the military bodies that have been with the same situation or even worse than me, and they pushing it. So if they can do it, I can do it. Anybody can do it, of course, and it'll help me out a lot because I've been having trust issues because the PTSD Now I can get out there, spend 1, 2, 3, 4 hours on the trail, being able to meet new people, compete. For me, I started, like I say, I started recreational, so I reach out to SOCOM, Special Operation Command, to they loan me a bike. I compete with them for the first time last year on the Water Games. I won a bronze medal. So of course I want to continue, but cycling sport is really expensive. As of right now, I don't own a bike. The bike is around $5,500. And I've been trying to reach around for organization, nonprofit, to see if I can get my own equipment, because I don't want to stop training because lack of equipment.
I only played basketball because I was taller than most students, like, since growing up, so I always knew I wanted to play. I play volleyball, I run track, and I play softball. I never dribbled a lot. I never could dribble, and I always played down. And this season, the guards had graduated last year, so I had to work all of the summer on my dribbling skills, and that was, like, very hard.
She's one of our captains, probably my main captain. She's our only senior. And I think there's, like, an unspoken, what's the word I'm looking for, a confidence where they believe in her, and there's a respect. She's been playing varsity basketball since she was in the seventh grade. So I think there's a lot of respect there that she's been here a long time. She knows what she's doing. She knows what's going on. And I don't really have to say a whole lot. Usually I just kind of give her a look and tell her what I need to be done, and it's going to get done.
We all grew up together. We all stay in the same neighborhood, all on the same street. So we all grew up together. So we all know each other. We had two new players transfer from, like, out of town, so it was, like, kind of hard to get used to them, because we was used to playing with everybody else because we played together before. But at, like, after a few games and practices, we got used to it, and now we play together better as a team.
And then going into high school, I made the high school team. But then after making high school, after playing on the high school team, I was like, I don't want to do this for the next 4 years. And then after I found out about cheerleading, I said, this is what I want to do. I felt like cheerleading pushed me more to work harder than baseball. Because it's just with baseball, it's one of those things where I've done it for so long that it started to lose its interest. And then cheerleading came, and I was like, this pushes me to be my best and pushes me to be my limit, and I loved it because I loved having a challenge.
Well, I originally met David because his sister cheered for me when she was in high school, and he was a baseball player, just a little kid that would come to our games and run up and down the bleachers, and I never thought, okay, David will cheer. Well, then going into his 10th grade year, he kind of was like, I want to cheer. And I was like, oh, David, I don't know. And then he's like, well, my dad doesn't want me to cheer. Can you call him? So I called his dad, and his dad's like, he's a baseball player. And I was like, I know, but, you know, just let him come to open gym. We'll see how it works out. And he fell in love with it. So his 10th grade year, he cheered on JV. In between his 10th grade year and his start of his 11th grade year, he really developed some strong technique in stunting. And I love going to competitions and watch people's face when the first time they see David, because he's not the tallest, you know, boy on our team. But so they'll be like, oh, that's their signature tumbler. Like, that's all he's gonna do. And then once he starts stunting, they're like, and he stunts? And in cheer, we call him that, meaning you're a hybrid, you can do both. And so he really has developed to be quite the hybrid in the cheer world.
Like Coach said, I mean, I'm not the tallest or the biggest guy. And whenever I first started cheerleading, that really affected me, I guess. But I didn't want to let anyone else notice it, because I didn't think that I could stunt. And whenever I first started cheerleading, I was like, all right, I don't know what I'm doing. This is something new, but I know I want to do it. And then I picked up tumbling pretty easily, but yeah, no, stunting was the hardest for me. Coach Olive, honestly, she is like a second mom to me. She's a great role model. She'll always be there to help you. And Coach Olive, the thing I like about her the most is that she always says it how it is.
She was a player that was recommended to me from some local coaches in the area, and I was still looking to recruit some players and hadn't had a chance to see her play.
My high school coach, I guess, I didn't really even know about this, but they had called her, talked to her.
My first day, nervous, completely did not tell her how to run the fitness test.
So it was pretty intimidating as a freshman. I had a large size large uniform that they had given me, so I definitely felt like the newbie of the team.
She worked her way up from being a walk-on to being a regular starter and an integral part of the team.
Became a captain her junior year, one of the best leaders on our team her senior year, and it was just a wonderful story to see her work so hard to become such a selfless leader.
From a freshman, you know, not knowing what that means to be the captain on the team, what you have to commit to your team when you are a captain. Yeah, when I was younger, I had to choose between softball and soccer, and I chose soccer. The main decision why I decided to go with soccer is I felt like it was always something happening. It's a lot more running than softball, which I regret sometimes, but I still believe I made the right decision. And I couldn't wait for her to finally become a freshman at George Jenkins and to be able to play.
They both played on George Jenkins' soccer team. I don't know that they interacted a whole lot at school, but you know, it was fun having them on the, sometimes Camille did not start, but having them on the field at the same time.
I was the senior captain on the team, so I had to kind of stay on her butt about things. Even though Camille is awesome and a great soccer player, as a freshman, you don't realize what it's like to be a senior. I don't really see him around campus because even now they have the new business building, so he's over there and I'm always over here.
There's always kind of a nice feeling in the back of your mind, your daughter's on campus here. I didn't actually run across her real often on campus, mostly just saw her after soccer games.
It's been cool, you know, I felt like it's gotten me a little bit of attention as well because everybody likes him, so then they give me attention because when they find out that I'm his daughter. My mom and my dad really, they did not want me to go to Florida State and they did want me to play soccer, but you know, I had to find my way there on my own. I'm truly grateful to both of them.
It gives you joy to come here and be involved with these kids, and it's very humbling. This is one of the programs that you can help them just have a normal Saturday like anybody else, just at the ballpark.
Come see one ball game and see what it does for these children. All of them, the buddies, come see what it does for the children who are actually playing the game. It's really hard at that point not to get involved some way, whether it's financially, whether it's with your time, whether it's having people in your organization come and volunteer. It just takes looking at the product on the field and seeing what it does for these children. And I think if they did that, I think we'd have people fighting to become sponsors out here at the Buddy Ball Field.
Although, you know, it's me sitting here talking to you right now, you know, it's really a very, very large team of volunteers that make all this happen. And the important part of this is the people who are out there with the kids, the coaches, the managers, the team moms, because those are the people that these kids are going to remember as they go through life. And I think that our greatest compliment is when we have children that come back through this program with their children. And that means that people that, you know, were running this league for so many years did something right, that they think this is where my child needs to play.
everybody. Segment number four, right after our athlete spotlights. And that was really made famous, I think, by ABC Sports during the Olympics and NBC Sports and some of these others, where they did this, you know, up close and personal. They go back and, you know, they talk about their hometown, their parents, their coaches, and the training. You know, I just always find that the most intriguing of all the little segments that we do.
Absolutely. Hey, this fourth and final segment brought to us by the Hampton Inn Lakeside. Want to make sure we mention them. I don't want to get too far down the road, but you're right, Mark. Absolutely. And it really starts with the individual. The individual has to train and have that inner desire. Then it goes to the team. The team has to come together. And, you know, at the All Sports Awards that we just recently had, I think it was like 14 state, national, or individual champions that were honored in the Circle of Champions.
It's so unbelievable.
It's unbelievable, absolutely.
Yeah, so it's, once again, it's really a cool part of living in Central Florida, living in Polk mm-hmm. County. And, you know, Neil, I've said it for years, it's just not a normal county. It's just not. And it's not the water. It's everything else. It's the culture that that creates these athletes. And, you know, as an athlete, you're going to compete, mm-hmm. you know, and we're involved in... with Polk County Tourism and Sports Marketing. Now, this is just sporting events, you know, 226 of these sporting events a year. That doesn't include the fairs, the festivals, the conventions, and all the other things. You know, you're looking at so many things that are pumping money, but the some of the things that people really either don't know about or maybe they may not be familiar with, boating, but really boat racing. The mm-hmm. Orange Cup Regatta has been around mm-hmm. almost as long as the Tigers have been in Lakeland. Gene Engel and Walt Engel, his father, was the one that started it. And, you know, it's entertainment, it's bolstering the economy. You know, it's great to watch mm-hmm. from a standpoint of, you know, the discipline, the timing. You know, there's a technology side to this whole thing. It's pretty cool.
Absolutely, and you talk about events that have been here for a real long time and then events that seem like they are recent, but now it's 4 or 5 years with the Ironman. 70.3 has been here.
Just signed another 5-year contract with Ironman for Haines City, and they just love Lake Eva. It's one of their favorite sites in the entire world. And every single year they say the same thing. Mm-hmm. They say the staff at Haines City Parks and Recreation, the economic development group with Cindy and those folks, and you know, the community as a whole comes out, supports the event. You know, it's just phenomenal. And of course, Russ Matt Baseball, one mm-hmm. of your favorites.
Yeah, absolutely. And you talk about over 200 teams that coming into Polk County, collegiate spring training, college teams pumping in that economic impact. They recently just signed an extension with adding four more fields to the Lake Myrtle Sports Park. So we could go on and on and on, but we got some great footage that highlight some of this.
Well, let's check that out, Neil.
Right.
And we'll see everybody here just in a couple of minutes. Stick around.
Well, you know, we're all athletes before injury happened. And I always say it gives us a second chance to be athletes again. You know, this is the number one sport in America, believe it or not, as far as recreation goes. Everybody has a softball team. And to be able to travel around the nation with a group of guys that have gone through the same hell that you went through with rehab, because, you know, when you're learning how to walk, run, do normal activities on a prosthetic leg, it's hell. You have to redo everything in your life. You have to learn how to run again, walk again, let alone trying to get out here and play competitive ball against only able-bodied teams. So it's very rewarding to get out here and do this. And, you know, you never know when your last out's going to be played. So one thing you see with this team is that we just go balls out as hard as we can every single inning, every single out. And it's very rewarding to be able to do this, and it's great to send a nice message to people, and it's great to see a good story coming out of the wars with all the news media and things like that. It's a lot of negative, and I think we're a very bright spot in that and a great comeback story.
being back here after a four-year layoff, and the improvements are tremendous. This place is great. The complex is great. Dave Bernard does a great job scheduling everybody. So we're really pleased with the results here coming here this week. We're in Tennessee right now. Memphis is where our hometown is. And we've already played 15 or 12, 13 games before we come down here. But it's just a great chance to come down and play in great weather, on a great venue, a bunch of great teams from all over the country. So it's a positive thing for us, big time. You know, for us, there is a little bit of a pressure just because we're always trying to get our way into the national tournament, so every game does count. But the difference is when we come down here, and the reason why I do it with our team, it gives us a great chance to get together for a week, 10 days, and be together, just the baseball team, outside of the college. And it really brings our kids together as a group. In general, so it helps us to get through the rest of the season. It's probably, especially at the Division III level, the kids coming together as a team is probably the biggest thing you have. And these road trips and come down to Florida for spring break is something that our kids treasure. So it's been pretty awesome.
Career Expo, Monday and Tuesday from 9 to 3 in the Exhibit Hall. It is now my honor to officially open the 2015 State Conference.
So my students are showing off the work that they have gone through to basically design, build, program robots, autonomous robots to achieve various tasks. And so they're here showing off the skills that were necessary to do that.
I am a ceramic sculptor. I bring some unusual animals, bright colored. They are sculpted, glazed, fired, broken apart, glazed, and reassembled. So you'll see a lot of different colors, a lot of different processes. There's actual gold and platinum used in my work. And at the end, I reassemble them with ceramic epoxy. Yeah, it's quite a process. I'm the only person who does it. What's unique about Mayfair here in Lakeland is that it is a volunteer-inspired show. So the people here that are putting this together, this is, you know, it's through the museum and the community. A lot of people spending a lot of time, a lot of effort, and they do a great job.
Offered the chance to be able to become the Warrior Games Army Assistant Coach for the sitting volleyball team for the Warrior Games. And this year I'm the head volleyball coach for the sitting volleyball team for the Warrior Games for the Army to teach some clinics for the Florida region of USA Volleyball. And then meet Nikki Nueves, which is on the Paralympic team. And we've gone out for now 2 years and taught clinics around the state, introducing to the adapted sport of sitting volleyball. What I've done here is I've offered the military, the men and women have made the Invictus teams or the Warrior Games a chance to meet once a month to practice their sitting volleyball skill.
So this is the third month that we've had it on a Sunday, and in the process of doing that, I was blessed to be able to meet some people in Lake Wales that work with the special populations, and invited the Circle of Friends Ministry, which is for the special populations, to come into here and work together and introduce the spirit of sitting volleyball to them and adapt the game to them now, and that's what's happening today. We have special populations within all of us, and it's just a service, I believe, that is necessary in our community. It's to build community partnership with all different kinds of people, all of us together, so we can work together. And what this does, sitting volleyball, and because I'm a volleyball coach, is not the only adapted sport out there. There's so many different avenues for these men and women and these children and these special populations can participate, whether it's Special Olympics or adapted sports specifically, whether it's water sports or wheelchair basketball. But a lot of times, because of some of these people cannot sit in a wheelchair and turn the wheels, sitting volleyball is a great avenue for abled and disabled students to come together, people to come together, special populations people to come together, and just have a really, really good time in fellowship and community.
Hey everybody, welcome back to segment number 4 of Sports Central. Man, Neil, we've had some just unbelievable footage, some interviews, the people of Polk County. I mean, it's just like, gee whiz, where does this stuff come from?
Absolutely, and we talked earlier in the show about some of those long-standing events and then recruiting new events, and an event that's coming up that we're very excited about, the Miss Florida pageant.
Well, you know, the Miss Florida pageant combines so many things. You know, it's part academic, you know, of course, your favorite, the swimsuit competition and gown competition. I know you like that.
I didn't say that.
He does enjoy the entire thing, and you were instrumental in helping bring that event here, Neil. And, you know, when a company or an organization the size and at the level of Miss Florida decides to move from a place like St. Pete, okay, with all the assets that they have,
right,
in St. Pete.
Entrenched there, really.
And ultimately move it to Polk County, to the Lakeland Center. I mean, that's something else.
You have to build trust, obviously, trust with the event, to the local community, the community to the event.
But what does it take?
There's new sponsors,
the trust, but I mean, there's a tipping point there. I mean, and what do you think in terms of recruiting? What is it? What sets us apart?
And they've told us the reason they came to Polk County is they saw the partnership, the community working together to want the event here, to show what the event could have when it came here, or if it came here. They've said the partnership between the organizations, the city of Lakeland, the Lakeland Center, the county, tourism, sports, there was a whole group.
Yeah, Commissioner Todd Dantzler.
Chamber of Commerce. And
yeah,
commissioners,
Howard Wiggs, and you know, the...
But that's not where the job's done, though.
No.
Once the event gets here, then the real work begins, so...
Yeah. Well, you know, Miss Florida is a real interesting. Mary was the 2016 winner. 2017 winner will go on to Atlantic City, New Jersey to compete in the national Miss America. And we've got a busy week coming up. But Neil,
go to LakelandCenter.com get those tickets. It's the 28th through the 2nd. But we do have some sponsors we want to thank. Holiday Inn Winter Haven, Abuelo's, Harry Seafood Bar Grill, Hampton in Winter Haven, and Contempo Vacation Homes. Got to pay those bills.
Don't forget, we also have a radio show, everybody, on 96.7 FM WLKF. Thursdays at 5 o'clock, called Sports Central, or 1430 AM on the Hall Communications Big Four Radio Group. Boy, great show there as well. And one of the most popular drive time shows of the entire time frame there. Well, Neil, our next live show is going to be July 8th. Always an exciting time heading into the dog days of summer,
yeah,
I guess. And of course, the NFL by that time is going to be a month away, so we're looking forward to that, and I think you guys are too. Well, I certainly hope you enjoyed this very special segment of the first 6 months of 2016. I know we did. Thanks so much for joining us, everybody, and we'll see you again next time.